So this next panel is going to talk about avoiding blackouts, the future of U.S. energy policy, and lessons learned from the winter 2021 Texas power outage. And I know they're going to talk about the global crisis as well. I'm going to introduce the panel moderator, and then they're going to come onto the stage, and then she will introduce the panelists. Jacki Pick Deason is host of the Jacki Daily Show, which educates, entertains, and engages America on all things energy. You really should check out her podcast. So wherever you find your podcasts, you will find the Jacki Daily Show. It airs Sundays on the blaze.com radio and airs on the dial in Texas each Saturday. And as I mentioned, the podcasts are weekly, which you can find on iHeartRadio, Spotify, iTunes, wherever you get your podcasts. Jacki was previously a senior fellow at the Texas Public Policy Foundation and also served as general counsel to an engineering firm specializing in energy, national security, and environmental cleanup. She served for many years as legal counsel on Capitol Hill to the chairman of the Subcommittee on the Constitution and the former ranking member of the Commercial and Administrative Law Subcommittee, advising on the oversight of federal agencies. Jacki studied economics, Spanish, and world history at Marshall University, Oxford University, and the University of Zaragoza in Spain. She is an alumna of Vanderbilt University Law School, where she served as the president of the law school's Federalist Society chapter. Jacki has an extensive network from which she draws guests for the Jacki Daily Show, including industry leaders representing all parts of the energy sector, government officials, journalists, and political insiders. Often, Jacki will know the day's most wanted guest and be able to secure the guest with a personal call, and I can personally testify that she already knew and had interviewed most of the speakers we have here today. Jacki is from the Ohio River Valley, where the shale runs deep. She descends from a long line of energy workers, including roughnecks, railroaders, coal miners, and nuclear energy specialists. You can follow Jacki at Jacki Daily Host on Twitter. I encourage you to do so. And let's give a warm welcome to our panel. If you believe it, then you can. There's a reason that this life can be electric. Oh, I can see it, see it. If you believe it, then you can. There's no reason. Will y'all take a seat? Sure. I'm going to sit these down before I get started. All right, my honor and pleasure to introduce our guest, Robert Bryce. Behind me. Yes, there he is. He is the co-producer of the documentary Juice, which aired here last night, How Electricity Explains the World. Robert is a Texas-based author, journalist, podcaster, film producer, and public speaker. Over three decades, his articles have appeared in the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, National Review, Field and Stream, and the Austin Chronicle. The documentary I just mentioned, Juice, he produced along with Austin-based film director Tyson Culver, released in mid-2020 and is now available on numerous streaming platforms. He's published six books, the most recent, A Question of Power, Electricity, and the Wealth of Nations, and spent 12 years as a reporter for the Austin Chronicle. 2006 to 2010, he was the managing editor of the Houston-based Energy Tribune, and 2010 to 2019, a senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute. He lives in Austin with his wife, Lauren, here at the end, who is an art teacher, photographer, and master potter. On this side is Blue Hulsey from Continental Resources. He's also senior vice president of HSE. He is responsible for strategic leadership of corporate HSE and ESG programs, along with guiding corporate policy and regulatory initiatives. And this is at Harold Hamm's company, as you probably know. He's past chairman of the North Dakota Petroleum Council, currently serves as the chairman of the Petroleum Alliance of Oklahoma, board member of the Domestic Energy Producers Alliance, or DEPA, Council for Secure America, and the Oklahoma City National Memorial Museum. A native Oklahoman, he has degrees from Oklahoma State and the University of Tulsa Law School. So we'll get started. Great.
I don't see the Beacon's uniforms, but I guess they'll do. Good afternoon. I'm going to talk about what happened in Texas, and this is a personal story for me. My wife, Lauren, is here. Last February 15th, we were blacked out for 45 hours. I'm going to talk about why that happened. Then I'm going to address, I revised my slide deck just a few minutes ago after hearing some of Andrew Dessler's comments with Alex Epstein. And then I'm going to talk about the EU and what has happened in the EU, because the Texas and EU cases are very important because they are so similar. Okay, so I'm not going to read this slide to you. I'll let you read it. 700 people died, not all of them because of lack of electricity. But I want to underscore this point. The ERCOT grid came this close, that close, from a complete meltdown. Bill Magnus said on February 25th in the emergency board of directors meeting that the ERCOT grid was within about 4.5 minutes of a complete shutdown. Now, I'm not going to spend much time on this, but think for just a minute. 26 million Texans plunged into darkness when it was snowing sideways, the temperatures were falling, and you couldn't travel. The roads were impassable. Had that happened, Texas would have had what biologists call a mass mortality event. It wouldn't have been 700 people died. It would have been tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people died. And it would have had ramifications throughout the entire rest of the country, because Texas, I'm from Oklahoma, I'm not here bragging about Texas. Texas accounts for about 10% of everything in America, the population, GDP, but for food, fuel, transportation, it is a critical state. And once, if the system had gone black, getting it restarted after going system black would have been effectively impossible, not just for days, but perhaps for weeks. It would have caused a nationwide recession. So let's be clear about the stakes here and about what almost happened because of mismanagement of the Texas grid. Okay, so the key point here, what is the key, you know, after the ERCOT disaster, all kinds of reports came out, a lot of academics, oh, don't blame renewables, oh, and those silly Texans, you know, those silly Republicans down there, they're saying, the renewables were partly the cause for this. Yes, absolutely. $66 billion. These are screen grabs. I'm going to show you a lot of screen grabs today. These are screen grabs from the wind industry lobby's own website and the solar industry's lobby. Their own numbers say approximately $63 billion. I added in a little bit of, you know, estimate for 2021. $66 billion spent on wind and solar in the years before the blackouts. Why did they spend $66 billion? Because they got $22 billion in subsidies. That's data from Bill Peacock, who's done the analysis on this. I mean, what kind of other business would you get into and you get a third of the money you spend in the form of subsidies? So what did that mean then? Well, you see a massive change in generation because of the subsidies. Hello? Wind energy increases by about 20%. Coal declines by about 20%. Nat gas stays effectively flat. Solar rises a little bit. Nuclear falls a little bit. The other thing that is never mentioned, and I do mean never, not in Texas Monthly, not in New York Times, not in these other, you know, national publications, that in the years before the blackouts, 6.2 gigawatts of coal-fired capacity was retired under pressure from the Sierra Club, environmental groups, et cetera. But you don't hear that, of course. That's not discussed because it doesn't fit the narrative. Okay, so what's driving this? Why, again, did this happen? Because the federal subsidies are driving the investment in ERCOT as well as the rest of the grid in the United States. It's a simple graphic. It's the only kind I can make. Probably the homeliest slide you'll see all day. This is Congressional Research Service data that I matched with BP data, pointing out on a per unit of energy produced basis. I denominated it in exajoules. I could put it in BTUs. I could put it in gallons of oil equivalent. Doesn't matter. An exajoule is roughly 1 trillion cubic feet of natural gas, roughly 1 quadrillion BTUs. If you don't know your SI units, you should. But the denominator is the same. The dollars per unit of energy produced basis, the solar industry is getting roughly 250 times more federal tax love than the nuclear sector. Wind industry, something like, what is it, 107, I've done the math lately, but oh yeah, those hydrocarbon guys, they're just getting cashing in when it comes to federal tax credits. Well, the numbers don't support that. So this is the story, and we didn't hear it from Professor Dressler talking about the subsidies driving solar and wind. I hear, oh, it's cheaper, it's cheaper, it's cheaper. I had to control my gag reflex over there. Okay. This is the slide that more than any other explains what happened. This is a slide that Art Berman created. Art graciously allowed me to use it. I'm not going to use the pointer. I'm going to walk over here. So what happened? This is January 30th in Texas. It was a nice day. The wind was blowing. And what happens? Wind drives out natural gas. It drives out some coal. And that's what wind does. When the wind is blowing, it reduces the amount of gas on the system. But then look right here. February 15th, when my lights went out, what happened? Solar and wind disappeared. $66 billion spent on wind and solar, and they went to Cancun with Ted Cruz. Gone. Disappeared. Went on vacation. Oh, but don't blame us. It's not our fault. It's the gas guys. Really? The gas guys go to almost zero. On January 30th, they go to about 40,000 megawatts in a span of a few hours, and they're the ones to blame. It's just not true. It is just not true. Another screen grab, exactly 6 months to the day after my lights went out. Screen grab from ERCOT's website, you can find it yourself. Here's February 15th. ERCOT warns of power shortages. 4 months to the day. It was hot that day in Austin, throughout Texas. Power demand is at 70,000 megawatts, about what it was about on February 15th when they started load shedding. Wind goes to zero. That's not the only one. Okay, so this is just last month. Again, high power demand. Now we're at 50,000 megawatts. Wind again goes to almost zero, again and again and again. They're not required to provide power when power is dear. And therein is the rub. And Dr. Dessler said, what he was saying is you have to subsidize the thermal generators to come into the market when they are needed. And so that the wind and solar guys can free ride, and that's the right word, on the thermal generators. Wood Mackenzie, their report, you don't have to believe me, one of the biggest, most respected energy consultancies in the world, issued their analysis in December. What did they say? The worst of the problems occurred during an extended wind drought. And I heard this, we'll just build more transmission. I'll come back to that. But it was over ERCOT, MISO, PJM, SPP for 12 days. A lot of people saying, there's gas. There was a lot of gas that was run down. The availability of gas prior to the blackouts fell. Yeah, it did, because the wind wasn't blowing. And what do they say? As the share of wind power rises, share of coal and gas decline, managing the grid to maintain supply is increasingly important. Yeah, hello, duh. I'm not a paid consultant, but I can agree with that one. So what did the Texas section of the Society of Civil Engineers report just last month? I reported on it in Forbes. These are the civil engineers, got no skin in the game. What are they saying? Badly designed market, absolutely true. Because in one watt on February 15th at 2 a.m. is worth more than a watt delivered, in the springtime when power demand is low. But these market deficiencies are the leading contributor to making the ERCOT system less reliable. They're saying the market is being distorted by federal subsidies. And I just showed you that slide. But it gets worse. This is data from ERCOT's website on their projected additions to the ERCOT grid between 2020 and the end of next year. That's 28 gigawatts of solar. That's nearly equal to all of the existing solar in California today. The amount of combined cycle gas being added is effectively zero. Why? Because, these business guys, they're pretty sharp. They know they can't make money in ERCOT. They're not going to build a power plant that won't pay back the money. They can't even get lending from banks to do it, because the banks are going to say, how are you going to make your return on your investment? Here's what it looks like. Again, a homely graph, the only kind I can make. But by the end of next year, we could have 72 gigawatts of wind and solar. That's more than the combined capacity of every form of gas-fired generation in Texas. We're preparing for a disaster that is potentially even worse than the one we just narrowly avoided. So what do we know? I won't go into all of these. I've said that the RTO model is broken. Regional Transmission Organization model is broken. I could give you chapter and verse on the amount of litigation that is now underway. Something I wrote about it in Forbes, 131 insurers have sued ERCOT. ERCOT doesn't have any money. ERCOT's a market manager. If those insurers prevail, and it appears they might, because the Dallas Court of Appeals just ruled recently that ERCOT doesn't have sovereign immunity. What are they? Are they a state entity or not a state entity? Well, I don't think they're a state entity. And if they are, who's going to pay all those property and casualty losses, the personal injury losses, unless the legislature steps in and says, King's X, we're not paying anything. I mean, this is a mess, and it's going to get worse. And one of the other key points here is the gas grid and the electric grids have merged, but they're still regulated separately. I showed you the slide about the call on gas. We retired all this coal, and gas was assumed, oh, well, you're just going to be the battery. We haven't told you you're the battery. We're not going to pay you to be the battery, but you're the battery. And then when you don't show up, we're going to have, people complain about you. But the problem is not fixed, not by a long shot. Okay, Professor Dessler isn't here. Too bad. Sorry. Wind and solar, say it the exact same way we're here. I wish he was sitting in the front row. Oh, it's cheaper. Okay, fine. My friend Lee Cordner says there are three things when you're planning new additions to the grid. Three things. Where are you going to put it? How are you going to connect it? How do you pay for it? He didn't have one word. Like so many of the academics, these spreadsheet jockeys who produce these elaborate computer models. Well, we have a computer model that says, well, it can do this. Okay, fine. Well, maybe you ought to leave Palo Alto and Stanford and MIT and, Cal Berkeley and go to small towns in Iowa. Or maybe spend a little time in rural California. Because in rural California, in Shasta, they just rejected a big wind project. Cherokee County, Kansas, Reno County, Kansas, San Bernardino County, California, the largest county by area in America, in 2019 banned large-scale renewables. This is in the state of California, which has a 100% clean electricity mandate by 2045 and a net zero goal by 2045. Vermont is listed there. Bernie Bros, any Bernie Bros in the crowd? I doubt it. Bernie Sanders has been one of the biggest promoters of renewables in the Senate. He ran in 2016 on a platform that said, we want 100% renewables, so that's great. You can't build wind turbines in Vermont. Can't build them in New York. And you can't build them in California. Where are you going to put it? How are you going to connect it? How are you going to pay for it? But it's not just wind, it's solar too. Solar's cheaper. Okay, fine. Ignore Uyghur slave labor. Ignore the fact that the U.S. State Department just sanctioned the import of solar panels and polysilicon from Xinjiang province, where 40% of the world's polysilicon for solar was being sourced. Forget that. You can still call your clean energy, even though you got a little slave labor in there. We'll just ignore that. Where are you going to put it? I just made this slide just a few minutes ago. That top thing from NBC News, they published that March 6th. I was like, yes, thank you. A big media outlet reporting on what's really happening on the ground in America. You won't read about this in the Washington Post. Actually, they did a pretty good story the other day about a tall grass prairie in Texas. You won't read about it in NPR. I wrote a piece in Quillette I published Monday just decrying their terrible coverage of the renewable business. You won't read about the New York Times. The New York Times will not cover the backlash against wind and solar in the state of New York. But the problem with solar, the same problem with wind, needs big footprints. And all across the country, people are saying, we don't want your stuff. How are you going to connect it? C3 Group in Atlanta, I finally got some good data on high voltage transmission. How much is actually being built? That third line, we're building about 1,700 miles of high voltage transmission, 230 kilovolts and above, since 2008. The amount of interstate, that is crossing state lines, is less than that, far less, like 250 miles. But even if we grant you that 1,700 miles a year, at current rates, doubling high voltage transmission to get to 90% renewable electricity will take 140 years. And yet these PhDs, I've just had it. I've had it. Oh, well, we'll do it all with wind and solar. Okay, fine. Oh, and we're just gonna double high voltage transmission. Okay, well, explain it to me slowly because I'm from Tulsa. You gotta go slower with Blue because he's from Skytook. Yeah.
Really slow, really slow.
How are you gonna build it? If you think building pipelines and putting them in the ground is hard, try doing the same thing with electrical infrastructure that's 150 feet or 200 feet high. State of Iowa has passed a law prohibiting the use of eminent domain for high voltage transmission. All across the country, rural communities are saying, we don't want high voltage transmission across our property, our county, our town. The grid we have is largely the grid we're gonna have. So it's not just massive amounts of high voltage transmission, it's cartoonish amounts of land. My daughter Mary made this slide for me. I quite like it just because it really pops. Two different analyses, one by David Keith and Lee Miller at Harvard from 2018, Vaclav Smil, who's a savant on all these issues, meeting existing electricity demand with wind alone. That's not the objective. Nobody's proposing that. It would require two Californias worth of land. Two Californias, you can't even build a single wind turbine in California, and yet these people are saying, oh yeah, we'll just do it again, we'll put it out there, you know, in flyover country. Eastern Colorado, Kansas, you know, those Trump voters out there. We'll put it out there, really. Again, my slide, data I've been collecting since 2015, more than 323 communities from coast to coast, from Maine to Hawaii, have rejected or restricted wind projects in the last 8 years. Wind industry has never challenged my numbers. They want to act like this doesn't exist. The facts are the facts. W. Edwards Deming said it right. In God we trust, everyone else bring data. I'm bringing data. This is the data. All of it sourced, all of it with URLs. You can find it on my website, robertbryce.com, the renewable rejection database. The solar advocates, the wind advocates, they don't want to talk about this. Doesn't fit their narrative. This is the reality. Okay, so what is all this doing? This is a piece I published in Forbes a few days ago. It's good for Generac, bad for America. In Generac's own investor presentations, now I know we have some CEOs from publicly traded companies, you don't publish data on your website or in your public reports unless you know that it's true. Because if you publish false information, you can go to the hoosegow. The SEC is not very happy about that. What is Generac saying about the increasing or the declining reliability of the grid? They're pointing to renewables, but it's not just Generac. The North American Electric Reliability Corporation in August published their report. You can see on that top, another screen grab, look at that top line, changing resource mix, they said is the most important issue in terms of the decline in reliability. And what else did they say? They said the same thing that Wood Mac said, wind droughts, solar droughts. Our grid is increasingly characterized as one that's sensitive to extreme widespread. Wood Mac said it was 12 days. This is the North American Electric Reliability Corporation. They're the ones who are responsible for reliability. Why would they publish it? Why would Generac say the same thing? Why would NERC say this? Because it's true. Wind and solar are cheaper, that's great, fine, I might accept that, except that they're bad for the grid. They're fragilizing our most important energy network. They're fragilizing, as John Constable says, self-poisoning the energy network that all of our other most important networks depend upon. It's a dangerous, dangerous trend that we're facing in the United States. What happened in Europe? It's a Reuters headline, wind droughts. You can talk all day long about Russia and Ukraine, and I can't believe the thuggery, I can't believe the maliciousness, the outright murderousness of this guy Putin. It's disgusting. But Europe drove themselves into the ditch by overinvesting in renewables, underinvesting in hydrocarbons, closing baseload power plants, and relying too heavily on imports. It's the same thing I said in front of the Senate Energy and Natural Resources Committee when I testified in November. This is the danger. Not saying I have any special insight, but this has been obvious for a long time. Okay, so storage. Oh, yeah, right. So Reuters says we need better storage. Okay, fine, let's talk about storage. I was just talking to my new friend Rita over here. She said, can you talk a little about batteries? Sure, I can talk about batteries. Again, Texas is about 1/10 of everything in the United States. We generate about 4,000 terawatt hours a year in the United States. Texas accounts for about 400 terawatt hours. Divide that by 365 days, you get about 1.1 terawatt hours or 1,100 gigawatt hours. A gigafactory produces about 50 gigawatt hours of batteries per year. The math is so simple, I can do it. To produce enough batteries to power Texas for one day requires the output of a gigafactory for 22 years. Scale. It's always about scale. Oh, wind and solar are cheaper. Oh, okay, great. I heard you say that about 15 times. So what is it? They spent too much on renewables, too little on hydrocarbons and nuclear, and now what are they facing? Economic ruin. I haven't checked the price today. The latest price, I checked it the other day, the TTF trading hub, that's the R. Henry hub in Holland, price of gas per million BTUs, last time I checked, $72. Spot price in Henry hub today is what, five? Yeah. Less than five. So what's that, 14 times, 14x, Europeans are now being forced to pay for natural gas because they didn't drill, and they bought this all renewable garbage. I have to thank my friend Doug Sandridge. He's here. I know we've talked about this quite a lot. So look at Germany. They're held up as this, you know, this great model to be followed. So let me give you a little preface. Since the days of Edison and Insull and Frank Sprague, they've had one idea in common, that they have you create a grid and you only produce enough capacity, or you only have enough machinery to meet demand. I mean, if you're a farmer, if you have a car, whatever, you know, even if you have a nice Ferrari or something, well, you leave it sit in the garage except for two Sundays a year when you drive it. Well, the miles per gallon for that Ferrari the cost is pretty high. But what has Germany done? They've nearly doubled their installed generation capacity. Note, they didn't close their coal plants, and they're going back to coal in a big way. I'll talk about that in a second. They nearly doubled their installed capacity, but they didn't increase the amount of electricity they're producing. So their capacity factor for their installed generation is declining and making all of this even more gobsmackingly stupid is that just a few days ago, the German government announced they're closing their existing nuclear plants. They decided, we're not even gonna extend the lives of our existing plants. This is after they closed three plants on December 31st. And you can't fix dumb. You can't fix dumb. But yet that's what they're doing. After all of this, even after the invasion of Ukraine, just the other day, the two ministries that decided they were gonna close the plants, the ministries that are headed by members of the Green Party. It's madness. So what's the iron law of electricity? I stole this idea from Roger Pilkey Jr. He's a friend of mine, he lives in Boulder. His work I admire quite a lot. He's a teacher at the University of Colorado. He coined the iron law of climate. He said, when forced to choose between economic growth and climate action, governments will choose economic growth every time. And so I thought about this a lot, and I thought, I like this idea of the iron law. And after being in traveling around the world, India, Iceland, Lebanon, Puerto Rico, what did I see? People are not going to sit in the dark. They will do whatever they have to do to get the electricity they need. This is from 2012 after Hurricane Sandy. Those red gasoline tanks, those are Tesla power walls for poor people. Beyond coal, Michael Bloomberg has given $500 million, pledged $500 million to the Beyond Coal campaign, which is now the Beyond Natural Gas campaign as well. Oh yeah, we're not going beyond coal. The spot price of coal in the Newcastle trading hub, Newcastle's the port in Australia, a major trading hub globally for seaborne coal, over $400 a ton. Met coal on the spot market in some places is selling for $600 a ton. The iron law of electricity is alive and well. and it's going to continue to be alive and well for a long time to come, because people are not going to sit in the dark. This is a little lanyap. I threw this in here because, you know, again, when it comes to industrial policy in this country, and we can talk about it for a long time, rare earth elements, we have no industrial policy. China does. And they're stealing a march on us in a big way. I know there's a reporter here from Denver Gazette. He said, let's talk about what's, you know, the plans for to build the nuclear reactors up in Kimmerer, Wyoming. Okay, we can talk about it. But those projects haven't even gone through the NRC approval process. And I'll bet you dollars to donuts they're going to get rejected, because the NRC should be renamed the Anti-Nuclear Regulatory Commission. They're not interested in growing nuclear. And just in the last couple weeks, I wrote a piece in Forbes and published it just a couple days ago. The NRC, with two Democrats in majority now, there are two seats still open on the NRC. Biden hasn't even appointed the additional two seats on the commission. They rescinded license extensions for two nuclear power plants, Peach Bottom in Pennsylvania and Turkey Point in Florida. If we're serious about CO2, serious about climate change, we have to get dead serious about nuclear, and we're not. If you're anti-nuclear and anti-carbon dioxide, you're pro-blackout. I am anti-blackout, especially since 2 a.m. last February 15th. Okay, so what are the lessons? Beware the fatal trifecta. That's Meredith Angwin's line. What's the fatal trifecta? Two, overdependence on renewables, overdependence on imports, and overdependence on natural gas. Now, we have a lot of gas guys here. Love me some natural gas, but it's a just-in-time fuel. What were the lessons from the ERCOT blackouts? The plants that did the best, and I showed you that before, the coal and nuclear plants, they had on-site fuel. So what are a lot of the power companies in the middle part of the country doing now? They're looking at on-site fuel storage. I was in Wichita last summer talking to the folks at the Kansas Power Pool. They're talking about getting a bunch of Wärtsilä recip engines. And I was the Wärtsilä vendor was there, and the guy from Kansas Power Pool was saying, well, yeah, we're gonna build some diesel storage. And the guy from Wärtsilä said, well, how much? Kansas guy said, 500,000 gallons. And the guy said, that's a lot of diesel. Yeah, it is a lot of diesel. Because they know having on-site fuel is key. On-site fuel is energy security. That's it. I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Okay, so Blue Hulsey. Do you have any reaction to what you just heard? I know you had some thoughts about the professor's observation that wind and solar were so cheap. Maybe Robert covered that for you, or maybe you have something to add.
Well, actually, I was going to add what he just said. I think is interesting. When you talk about what has happened in our country with the regulators, and I think a lot of this, when we talk about, let me go back a little bit. We're with Continental Resources. We're an oil and gas producer out of Oklahoma, but we also produce in the Bakken. We know how to produce in very cold weather, and most everyone in our business knows how to produce in very cold weather. The Permian guys aren't just in the Permian. That's just where they're located. That's where they're at the time. They all know how to do this. But what has happened is you look at the margins, and from a just-in-time fuel, you can be just-in-time, but there's costs associated with just-in-time. And so what happens is we've government incentivized wind and solar, and you have state officials who are sitting in these utility boards and saying, okay, really, when a utility comes to me, they're trying to get the lowest cost electric unit to the customer, and that's what they're being elected by, and they take a lot of, and they should, by the way. I'm not criticizing them at all, but what they have to do now is include that reliability factor, because that is key. And what does that cost? I'll tell you right now, Oklahoma is definitely seeing a cost. We're going through securitization in Oklahoma. It's a $4 billion. If you want to know what is a true cost to an Oklahoma consumer for wind and solar, when we've been going for almost 20 years, Oklahoma is a huge, we're the second largest wind producer, we're the second largest wind producer in the country. We're not afraid of wind. In fact, the oil and gas industry isn't afraid of wind. We want to compete on a level playing field, of course, but we're not afraid of the resource. We're not afraid of more energy. That's a great thing for our country, our state. I do need to say, Robert mentioned, I'm from Skytook, Oklahoma. And that's in Osage County. By the way, they do have a ban on wind turbines in Osage County by the Osage tribe. It was a great place, but the Osage County is where the Nellie Johnson well was over 100 years ago. We've been producing oil and gas in Oklahoma. We know how to do this. Most of the regulations in this country are coming from Oklahoma. We're not afraid to be regulated. We're drilling oil and gas right now in wells and in areas that have been explored 100 years ago. That's how much the resource. They put wells in areas where we're going horizontally and stimulating rock, and a huge amount of resource is available for Oklahomans. We're on a vast resource of gas. And what we've done is incentivize wind and solar and not put a primary, if you will, a cost on that reliability. And that's something that I think we're going to have to see going forward.
And the wind industry is going to fight that tooth and nail.
Yes.
And the solar industry is the same. They don't want to provide firm power when power is dear. Sorry to interrupt.
No, I think that's exactly right. I mean, we're already seeing that. We're going to the commission because really, you know, I work for Harold Hammond. Harold is about solutions. I promise you he's working right now. He was working yesterday. He's going to work on Monday for solutions for our country. Gas prices, oil prices are high right now. That we would rather them be lower. We're working to provide more energy to the consumer. We want our economy to run smoothly, and we need a lot of energy to do that. We understand that. We're working right now to try to get solutions through our utility sector so that they understand we've got wind and solar being proposed in Oklahoma right now. And I can promise you we're reviewing those proposals and saying how do we prevent this from happening again? Right now, if you're on a fixed income in the state of Oklahoma, your utility bills are going to go up around $5 a month. That's real cost that's the cost of global warming. When Professor Dessler says this is cheaper, I can promise you what we're going through is impacting consumers today. And that's where we don't it just gets lost. And those are real people. I mean, you talk about energy poverty. Energy poverty is in America. It's happening. And we talk about, and I think it's right, our ESG story is bringing cheap, reliable, affordable, abundant energy around the globe, and I think that's something we need to be doing. But we also need to be bringing it to our people. We also need to be providing jobs, create manufacturing. All those things that energy does, we need to be doing it, in our case, in Oklahoma, North Dakota, and the places we operate, but across the country, and we're falling down on that.
So, I can just follow on the securitization issue, because I didn't know the Oklahoma number being $4 billion, but Rayburn Country Electric Co-op, one of the bigger co-ops in Texas, they just finalized a securitization deal for their excess electric costs, and it's to the tune of $900 million.
Yeah.
So, and then you have Brazos Electric, in my first slide, they declared bankruptcy for $1.8 billion.
Yeah.
So, you know, we don't know in Texas how much the total securitization costs are going to be, because that's only the electric providers, because the gas providers are also, the bills that passed the Texas legislature also allow the gas providers to securitize their excess costs as well. So, you know, this idea, oh, it's cheaper, it's cheaper until it ain't.
Right.
And what we're seeing now is where it ain't, because these utilities are having to be made whole, and they're trying to avoid rate shock for their ratepayers, so they're securitizing the debt and paying it out over 20, 30 years.
Exactly right. Exactly. We're seeing the same thing in Oklahoma, and it was up to $4 billion. It's going to be in the billions. It's going to be billions of costs to consumers in Oklahoma that they haven't seen yet. And they're going through a process. So sometime in 2022, their bill is going to go up $5 for the next 20 years. And what happens if that happens again? What happens if another storm comes through? And we haven't made, a baseline cost, a baseline of production of a combined cycle plant that's part of your system, it's an insurance cost. It's either $2 billion now, or we can have a little bit higher rates long-term that aren't free from wind and solar or being subsidized. Again, we are paying those, but we're just not calculating that in the rate that we're charging consumers. So the consumer's gonna pay. And that's the problem is, but we have to put a factor on the reliability, and that's gotta be a pretty high factor.
The press probably left the impression that what happened in Texas was a uniquely Texas problem and a one-off event. So people kept talking about unprecedented storm. This only happens once every 50 years or once every century. So they give the impression that it's behind us and we don't need to worry about it now, which I think is a really dangerous way to think about the problem. On the first question, is this a problem for everyone in the room in other states, not just Texas, because our grid is self-contained, which is unique? And second, is this a one-off problem, or are we in fact looking at this happening again? Should we expect this to happen again, in Texas at least?
Well, I mean, certainly it can happen again. I mean, just because it's once in a 100 years doesn't mean that 100 years doesn't, the clock resets every year, right? We had a major storm in 2011, in which FERC, after the storm, made a lot of recommendations. The regulators didn't follow through. And they included some about winterization and understanding what my point about the gas grid and the electric grid merging. And that's clearly the case because we've gone now, in my first book was on Enron back in, 20 years ago. Nationally, we were burning about 5 trillion cubic feet a year for in natural gas for power burn for the in the electric sector. Today, we're close to 12 trillion cubic feet per day, or 12 trillion cubic feet per year. So the electric grid has become more and more dependent on gas, but the two systems are still regulated separately, the two networks. And so there has to be some rationalization, not just in Texas, but across the country to recognize this as it's an attribute if we just look at CO2, but it's a vulnerability when it comes to high demand periods.
Yeah, and I'll just add, I mean, I think, and Alex spoke to it earlier about the true cost of energy, and I think that's one of the things that we really need to be paying attention to. The true cost of energy, if you really want to put wind and solar into the true cost of energy for gas and coal, you've got to put battery storage in that. I understand what the professor was talking about from a grid perspective, but it doesn't really work like that because you're not meeting in a room and go, you put a gas, we'll put a solar, we'll do, you know, it's a state-by-state perspective. And by the way, those states can pass certain laws that are that impact the overall grid. So it's really a function of making sure state officials are paying attention to their own grid and making sure that the reliability within that body and the decision-making process has a cost associated with it. Let me also add one thing too. I think the oil and gas industry had gotten a bad rap for not necessarily working through. You saw the headlines of the natural gas failed during that storm. And I will tell you, the only reason I'm here is because I work with 1,300 direct co-workers at Continental and thousands of individuals that are employees and subcontractors. In fact, we have just a reference number. When you talk about the oil and gas industry, we as a one company work with nearly 400 companies that are 10 people or less. So we have a lot of small contractors, and I promise you, those guys worked their asses off. 24 hours a day during that storm. They were out there. We had heaters that we were bringing in from states across the country. I mean, this is not a lie. We had guys at Lowe's buying space heaters, and because they could figure out a piece of equipment that they could keep warm and keep flowing. I mean, the ingenuity that went on. It's interesting in Oklahoma, and I know we have some, may have some utilities in the room and some co-ops. And what has happened, and what had happened in the Permian, it happened in Oklahoma, is we had a utilities required to shed load, and some load shedding occurred. Well, what happened was the utilities didn't necessarily know where that load was and the impact that was going to happen. So if you shut a load on a compressor station that we're putting gas into, it's directly impacting our ability to put gas into the line. And so that has implications. We've worked through some of those solutions. That's a communication problem. But that's one of the things. It occurred. You had freezing lines because they were just shutting down electrical systems, not realizing they should probably, it's critical infrastructure. It's like a hospital because basically you're shutting down your system once you shut compression off.
Right.
So that was another solution that we worked on there in Oklahoma. And I know they've done the same thing in Texas.
Yeah. If I could just add one other quick thing about what your point, Blue, was that electricity ain't hot dogs. It ain't tortillas. It's not a commodity. It's a critical service. And I think one of the key problems in this whole discussion has been that policymakers and regulators and legislators, they don't understand what the grid is. And it's a complex network. It's not, you know, we buy watt hours, but what we need are watts. One thing I thought Dessler got right, we don't care about energy, or no, it was Chris, he said, we don't care about energy, what we want is power. But we have to have that power instantaneous all the time. So that failure to understand the grid as a complex network that cannot be allowed to fail, I think is at the root of a lot of this misunderstanding about what is actually going on and what the regulatory response should be.
Yeah, that's right.
So, Robert, if ERCOT had shut down, why would it have taken so long to restart, the audience asked?
Well, how long do we have? Well, the main load shedding, our power went out for less than 2 days. But, you know, there were other people across the state who were without power for five days, right? Again, I think it goes to the complexities of the network and that and I can't say this for certain, but I think it's also that the utilities themselves didn't know which circuits were the ones that should be kept on and which should be kept or should be allowed to be turned off. I didn't learn until just the other day that one of the hospitals in downtown Austin was shut off. Well, that's a no-no. I mean, a real no-no. So I think this is part of this RTO model and where we have this massive crisis, but the buck doesn't stop anywhere. Mm-hmm. Right? Oh, it's a market. We're going to depend on the market. Well, that doesn't work for this business. It's not, you just can't leave it to the market. If we learn nothing else, that's the lesson we have to learn here. And so it's a huge problem because these RTOs around the country, SPP, MISO, PJM, CAISO, none of them have a mandate for reliability or resilience. So how do we fix that? If you made me king, every state would go back to the Public Utility Commission. They would regulate the utilities in their state, yeah. Full stop, make sure that they put reliability and resilience as job one.
Yep.
But why is restarting it a matter of weeks instead of days or one day?
Well, part of it is if we're going to get down to grid inertia, right? The issue of since the days of Edison and Insull, the grid has relied on these big spinning pieces of steel. And I moderated a panel in San Antonio I speak to a lot of rural co-ops. I spoke to the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association in Nashville on Monday. And it was a co-op event in San Antonio in 2017, and Bill Magnus, who's now the former CEO of ERCOT, was on the panel. And Lauren and I had just come back from Australia, I remember, where the grid was failing, and grid inertia was an issue on the front pages of the newspapers. Well, that's the ability of the grid to maintain its momentum, right, to ride through faults. And so I asked Magnus, well, what about all this asynchronous generation you're adding, the solar and wind? And he said, at a certain point, I want a just big piece of spinning steel, right? So when you lose some generation, you have to synchronize that new generation that failed to the same 60 hertz that's on the rest of the grid. And that may have to be done by one generator at a time. So again, it's an extraordinarily complex network that requires coordination among a lot of different players. And when it goes south, it can be horrifically difficult to get it restarted.
Okay.
Can I add one thing? You know, in Oklahoma, we around 2005 put a goal of reaching 15% of our capacity and electricity by wind. And this is in Oklahoma. Governor Mary Fallon pushed this initiative. And, you know, we're an oil and gas state. We're an energy state. We're not, again, against wind. But what has happened is they have taken that federal subsidy and exploded that development. And it's funny to me, and I used to work for a guy named Jim Inhofe, and Jim Inhofe would also often answer a question. And after he was done with his answer, he'd say, I don't know what your question was, but that's your answer. So I'm just going to tell you. What is funny to me is in the Build Back Better bill, you have $55 billion. It was $55 billion for green initiatives. It was including ratcheting back up the wind and solar incentive. So when we talk about it being the cheapest, reliable energy, or unreliable energy, if you will, They're still getting government subsidies. They're still expanding government subsidies. If you want to know our government energy policy, in 2015, we began to export oil out of this country. In 2015, 7 years ago. That's where we are. So we the tail wags the dog from a policy perspective, and that's a big problem, I think, going forward, is you're still going to see, I mean, even in the bills that are coming forward, we're in D.C. a lot, talking about what's going on, talking about energy policy. Harold just recently met with Senator Kerry, Secretary Kerry. It was a really interesting meeting. Harold did an interview with Financial Times, and Secretary Kerry read that article and called him up and said, you said in the Financial Times article you couldn't get a hold of me, I'd love to meet. So of course Harold goes right up to D.C. and we sit down with him, and it was a cordial meeting, and Secretary Kerry was a gentleman. They didn't agree on a lot of stuff, but one of the most interesting things...
Do tell.
One of the most interesting things is, you know, Harold says, well, we got to get, you know, we got to look at equity in energy and understanding these subsidies that you're giving wind and solar. We need to be on a level playing field. And he goes, Harold, you have been getting, oil and gas has been getting subsidies for years. And Harold just kind of looks at him, he goes, okay, this is the one thing I am going to have to disagree with you. He goes, when I was in North Dakota and I drilled 17 dry holes, 18 if you really want to talk about it, uneconomic. He goes, no one ever gave me a dime. He goes, what you're talking about is a manufacturer. If you leave nothing from today, please take this. When anyone says oil and gas gets a subsidy, this is what they're talking about. It's a manufacturer's deduction. It's called an IDC. Anyone else, when you guys, the titans of industry, when you build a building, you can expense it. It's an expensing process. What they've done in DC is put that something different for oil and gas, and they use that number to throw at us as an expense. So that's the subsidy they're referring to, and it's got to stop. It's silly, and that's what Harold was talking about. Look, this is silly. You're subsidizing. You're giving wind money to produce, and you're actually saying that a expense is a subsidy, and that's a problem. That's not relying on being honest. That's where he talks a lot about IQ versus EQ. About we've got to have high IQ in energy and not be emotionally tied to some of these policies. And so that's what we're doing. That's why I think, I mean, Harold's been committed to meet with this administration, and we would love to meet with them. In fact, you know, when our guys pulled up, again, going offside, on the 9,000 permits, I mean, we have looked at all of those. Most of them are in four counties in the U.S. 9,000 permits, most of them in four counties. Think about that. Think about if you were trying to drill all of those. But they don't talk about that. They don't talk about it. It shows their willingness or unwillingness, if you will, to talk to the American energy industry and work towards solutions. And I think that's where we're going to have to get towards to really find solutions that's going to help all of the country.
Can I just add one quick point on the PTC? So you mentioned the Build Back Better. So the production tax credit for wind, I mentioned those in my slide deck, and the ITC. Well, in the Build Back Better Act, there were 5-year extensions for the PTC and the ITC. So if these forms of energy are cheaper, why do they need subsidies? And the other key number here is that the production tax credit was going to be put at $25 a megawatt hour, 2.5 cents per kilowatt hour. $25 a megawatt hour in Texas, that's roughly equal to the wholesale price of electricity in the state. So how can anyone compete with an entity that is getting a subsidy that is equal to the market price? You can't. And that's one reason, a key reason why no thermal generation is being built in Texas, because it's uneconomic. And until they address that, the reliability and the reserve capacity in the state is going to continue to decline. Well, at the same time, everyone from California is moving to Austin.
And they're also giving tax subsidies within the state as well, property tax reductions.
Right.
You're charging a production tax to oil and gas. You're not getting that in Texas on wind. We're not doing it in Oklahoma. It's those kinds of inequities where you really, on apples to apples, that you're going to have to look at those kinds of things in the future. I would propose Texas does need to be charging a production tax on wind. I mean, that to me, that levels the playing field.
So a question about getting out of this vulnerable position we're in Texas. Same with Europe, right? They're vulnerable to Russia because they're unable to produce efficiently what they need right this second. Blue, if Boris in the UK and the European leaders decided, starting right this second, we're going to reverse course and hit the accelerator on our own production, and everyone were on board, how long would it take them to ramp up? Because we had this talk about in the United States, you know, how much time would it take, and how much money would it take for U.S. producers to bring down gas prices? It's kind of a similar question. These things don't just happen overnight.
Yeah, and it's interesting and complex because you're hearing large oil and gas CEOs talk about they're not willing to expand. In fact, if you look at the market reaction to Russia or the United States policy on Russian imports, major stocks went down because they were afraid that costs were going to increase in the oil and gas industry, that production was going to increase. And what has happened is that's a much more broad issue because you have an administration that has put an issue on loaning money, an issue on we want to end this, we're not going to give infrastructure. You saw the Secretary of Energy talk just last week, hey, we want more production. And I think it was mentioned earlier, well, we haven't seen anything from that. We haven't seen policy changes. We haven't seen, there is a full scale, okay, we were wrong. You know, and the president, to his credit, during the State of the Union, basically said, let's defund the police. Oh, I was wrong. Let's fund the police. I'm not saying he's going to do that with energy, by the way, but it would take that kind of large-scale adoption of, you know what, we're going to have energy, we're going to have fossil fuel energy, hydrocarbon, reliable, affordable energy long-term in this country, and we're going to do it cheaply and reliable, and I'm going to work with this industry, and I encourage investment. I think that kind of chit played by the president, played by this administration, which of course is probably just wishful thinking, but...
It is. I'll just add on that. Remember, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission just passed a rule last few days that any new pipeline project has to pass some climate hurdle.
Right.
So at the same time, these Biden appointees are undermining our nuclear sector. They're undermining our ability to build pipelines. But I think, Jacki, your question is really important. And on Tuesday on my podcast, I had Benny Pizer. He's with the Net Zero Watch. He's based in London, actually, in Liverpool. And we talked about this, about how long would it take for the UK then to, I mean, they can reverse the fracking ban pretty well right away, but how long is it going to take to get an AC top drive rig into the shale bearing zones in the UK with a good crew, with a sand chief, with all the, you know, the frack spreads and all of the roustabouts, tool pushers, and the roughnecks, the people who know what they're doing. They're gonna have to come from Oklahoma, Texas, Colorado, Louisiana, and there's a limited supply. And the supply is limited now more than ever because we've laid down so many rigs. So there's no doubt in my mind, the UK, all of Europe, they're gonna have to start drilling and they're gonna have to start right damn now. But it's gonna be a years long process because they don't have the human infrastructure or the physical infrastructure that's going to allow them to do, like, you know, the ramping of the production in the Permian, where, you know, the most drilled province in the world and is now probably the hottest oil and gas play in the world still. But you have all that infrastructure ready to go so they can ramp up production pretty quickly. But it's going to be hard. There are going to be land use conflicts. There are going to be people who don't like it. And you count on the Sierra Club opposing it.
On a side note, in World War II, there were roughnecks from Oklahoma that drilled oil wells in the UK for oil and gas production. And that's, I mean, if you talk about you know, if you've got a problem, give a roughneck and some duct tape, they're going to solve it. I mean, that's what our industry does. And they will solve problems, but just get out of their way. And we can do stuff. But you got to be incentivized to invest.
Well, let me ask you, so, I mean, what about at Continental? I mean, are you able to find enough people to man your crews?
So if we, I don't...
And do they have to pee in a bottle and can they tap?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. No, I mean, that's, if you look at where we are from a rig perspective, you know, we were at 1,600 rigs. We're at 600 rigs operating right now. A lot of folks that we've lost from this industry aren't coming back. We're training new people. I will tell you, I work on our HSE team. Safety is something we talk about every day because there's so many new people in our industry and they don't understand, they're learning how to deal with what we're, the equipment, all of those things. But yeah, it's gonna take, it does take some time. It absolutely takes some time. But I would argue that it's the overall sense of, we're not even, I mean, we've got folks, we've got great young people in this room, and you're gonna, let me just tell you, oil and gas is going to be around for a long time. Don't be afraid to be in the oil and gas business. And Harold says it all the time.
But how many people are you short? I mean, right now, truck drivers, you know, rig workers, your crew.
There is no question it is a constraint, without a doubt. We are constrained.
100, 200, 300?
I can tell you right now, if you wanted to go out, prices are increasing day by day already because of the lack of rigs that are available.
On wages.
On wages, on rig times, on frac crews, everything. I mean, the amount of steel that's available just isn't there. I mean, Chris knows that more than anyone. So absolutely. However, we've been in this position before, and we can come out. But it's investment into the process. It's investment, and it's long-term. That's the other problem is, when you're talking about investing, and Chris is a great... These are not cheap pieces of equipment, and your investors want to go, well, you're going to put these to work long term, right? And we're not going to get switched like a pipeline. It's not going to get its permit pulled after it's nearly already built, right? That would never happen. The rule of law is in this country. And what has happened is it has made every energy investor skittish. Mm-hmm. Because how do you rely on that? If I'm not skittish if I put it in Apple, Apple's gonna be fine. Do I have to take money out of Apple and put it in oil and gas? Well, I've gotta have reasons behind that. And there's a lot of policy that I think will incentivize that.
Well, even if they weren't skittish, what about the ESG constraints, right? Capital not flowing to oil and gas producers because people wanna divest, it's not green. How big a problem is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely, you're seeing that change a little bit, I think, with, Mr. Fink's reversion on, hey, by the way, we're going to need oil and gas. It's amazing when you become profitable how quickly but I will tell you, it's also the oil and gas industry telling its ESG story better. We've always had a good ESG story, talking about what we're doing in not just environmentally, but what we mean socially, and getting better environmentally as well. We're paying attention to those issues. We're communicating them better. And I think it's going to really broaden the investment horizon for who's investing in oil and gas in the future.
If I can just add one quick point on the ESG. So I'm from Tulsa. Alliance Resource Partners is a Tulsa-based company. So I'm acquainted with Joe Kraft. He's the CEO of the company. And I had him on my podcast a month or so ago. So I think I said the second largest coal producer in the eastern U.S. Well, they're producing about 36 million tons a year. They could easily expand because the market, the demand for coal is so high. But then he just casually says, I said, well, what about ESG? And he said, we have 14 bankers in our revolving line of credit. Seven of them have told us they won't be back because of ESG. Here's a company that's not doing anything illegal, not even immoral or fattening, and their bankers are cutting them off because of ESG. So this is, I think it's a cancer on capitalism. And it's an unaccountable cancer that is made by a lot of people who don't have any accountability to shareholders, don't have any accountability to the general public. And the Russia's invasion of Ukraine should be an inflection point. It should be a point in time where policymakers understand we have to have energy security, and energy security depends on having homemade energy, domestic energy, and a robust dynamic energy industry. We have that, but it's being undermined by this fad.
Can I add one thing? And I just want to say thank you to the Institute, and thank you to Jennifer and your team. You and everyone here, that are, these events matter. and your time and your treasure matter. And we do this a lot at Continental, and sometimes it looks like you're, feels like you're fighting alone. And when you can come into rooms like this and really have these conversations, it's super incredible and helpful. So thank you so much for having us. And I will say, this is the worst beer I've ever had. But I'll look forward to a Coors Light later.